Good morning. Thanks to all of you for being here. I'm King County Executive Dow Constantine. Last Friday in South King County, federal authorities arrested Daniel Ramirez, a 23-year-old man with a work permit, arrested him at his father's home. Ramirez was arrested by immigration officials despite his status as a dreamer. He's one of those who was brought to the United States as a child, who has lived here all his life, and who was protected by a law signed by President Obama. His only confirmed brush with the law in Washington is a speeding ticket in 2016. Even before this made national news yesterday, people in neighborhoods throughout King County and throughout Washington State have been feeling afraid. Afraid for their human rights, for their families, for their safety. And they have every right to feel afraid. There's the fear that federal agents will come into their homes and take away someone else who has a legal right to be here. This president continues to push his unconstitutional travel ban that would separate families, even those who lived here for years as peaceful, contributing members of our community. People who've helped build our region's prosperity now live in legitimate fear of the United States government. People who have lived their whole lives here, who remember nothing else, live in fear of the only nation they have ever known. This week on Beacon Hill, a member of the Somali community, a citizen of the United States, just like you and me, told my team that he is afraid to board an international flight out of fear that he may never be able to see his family again. Those who are not immigrants, those who are not refugees, still fear what might become of their friends, their family members, their neighbors, their co-workers. Then there is the threat, the very real threat to our region's economy, preventing local companies from recruiting the talent they need to help us all succeed in this 21st century economy. Now, last fall, I included funding in the county budget to create a permanent immigrant and refugee commission, one that will align the work of our partners and community-based organizations and expand their capacity. That new commission will be staffed and operational this summer. But a lot has changed since last fall. We need to deploy additional resources right now. Now is the time for us to fight for the safety and the dignity and the equality of all who live here. Now is the time for action. Today I am announcing three actions that will move us forward, and we are going to move forward on these immediately. First, I will transmit an ordinance to the County Council tomorrow that will provide $750,000 in rapid response services. Combining that with an additional $125,000 from the Seattle Foundation, we will establish a legal defense fund that will provide pro bono guidance through the naturalization process. Develop and distribute Know Your Rights education materials, a program in multiple languages so that everyone knows what to do if they are approached by a federal agent or are victims of a hate crime. Strengthen information hubs operated by nonprofits so that everyone in King County, including those who want to support immigrants and refugees, knows where to go for resources, for alerts, and for opportunities. Second, 65 elected officials from throughout King County have signed a pledge to protect those in their community, to affirm that we are a welcoming community, including those who came here from other countries yearning to breathe free. Third, we will ensure that all King County facilities are ready, safe, and equipped to assist immigrants and refugees, starting with signs at multiple locations that clearly announce all are welcome here. Our message to this White House, to our country, to the rest of the world is clear. We proudly uphold the fundamental American promise that we are and we will be a nation of hope and freedom and opportunity for all. We stand united with other metropolitan regions across the country, with New York and Los Angeles and others, regions that have created legal defense funds to defend the human rights of every member of our communities, regardless of where they were born. I thank everyone here for joining us today. And I particularly thank those who stand behind me this morning as we announce this community-wide effort, and everyone in this community who stands with us. And I'd like now to introduce to you the chair of the King County Council, Joe O'Kirby.
Thank you. 2 weeks ago, the County Council adopted a motion declaring that King County was a welcoming, safe, and affirming place for all residents of our county. We now have the opportunity to back up those words with real action, with real benefits for our friends, our family, and our neighbors. Almost one in four King County residents are foreign-born. This is not an issue of helping a small number of individuals who are new to our region. This investment is about helping families who make up the fabric of our communities, from Kent to White Center to Mercer Island to Kenmore. This investment is specific and immediate, and my hope is that it will serve as seed funding to leverage additional regional and possibly national partner funding to ensure that we're meeting the short, medium, and long-term goals of our community. I'm proud to be working with Executive Constantine, colleagues on the County Council, Mayor Baker, and the community leader standing with us this morning to make sure that we get this investment passed through the Council and start helping families today. To all King County residents who happen to have been born in another country, our message this morning is clear. You are welcome, we support you, and we will surround you with support and services. It's now my pleasure to introduce the Mayor of Kirkland and the President of the Sound Cities Association, David Baker.
Thank you, Joe. However, I'm the Mayor of Kenmore.
Kenmore, I'm sorry.
That's okay. I'm really, really honored to be here today representing the 38 cities in King County. And I want to thank Executive Constantine for inviting city officials to join the Pledge of Inclusivity. And I applaud the Executive and the County Council for funding additional services to support immigrants, refugees at this time of uncertainty for many. The cities of King County are diverse. The diversity in our populations is foundational to our community culture, our economy, and our vibrancy as a region. To give you an example, the city of Tukwila. The city of Tukwila, over 80 languages are spoken in the schools. 70% of the students, English is a second language for them. It is the most culturally diverse city in the nation. We are all immigrants, if you stop and think about it. All of our families came from somewhere else, somewhere back in history. So I think it's important that we show our solidarity with immigrants and to provide what help we can for immigrants. And we're a nation of immigrants, and we must continue to promote fairness and equity for all. Our residents who are immigrants and refugees are not problems that must be dealt with. They contribute to our region's prosperity and quality of life. Many cities have adopted resolutions and ordinances committing to be welcoming and inclusive jurisdictions, and some of them are here today. And I'm pleased that over 65 elected officials in King County from over 26 cities so far have signed on to the pledge, and I know more are signing. This pledge demonstrates that working in partnership with the county, we're able to make a unifying statement of promoting welcoming and inclusive communities across this country. And we value and will uphold the rights of all people. It's now my pleasure to introduce Jorge Barone, the Executive Director of Northwest Immigrant Rights Project.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. My name is Jorge Barón with Northwest Immigrant Rights Project. And I want to just first start by thanking Executive Constantine, Councilmember McDermott, and Mayor Baker, and all of the other leaders who signed on to the pledge for announcing this important initiative. I think as you heard from Executive Constantine, we are experiencing in our communities a tremendous fear about the impact that the policies of the Trump administration are going to have on many people. But I want to say that in our view, these initiatives are important not just because of the important benefits that they can convey and the message and symbolic nature that is also important sending to immigrant communities and refugee communities in our county, but also because it improves the lives of all residents of King County. When there's been a lot of research showing that communities that are welcoming, that are inclusive, have better economic development, have lower crime rates. So this is important for all of us who live in this county to be welcoming and inclusive. This is not merely about supporting immigrant refugee communities, which you should do, but we should do it because it's better for all residents of our county. So I appreciate the fact that we're going to start with this response fund. We think it's important that people know about the legal rights that they have. We think it's important that people understand that everybody who lives in the United States has basic constitutional rights that have to be respected. We've been proud that here in King County, our judiciary has already been stepping in to stop some of the practices and some of the actions that the Trump administration has taken this past month. And we will continue to make sure that those basic values are going to be respected in the courts and in other ways through making sure that people have accurate information. As far as Northwest Immigrant Rights Project and a lot of the community organizations that are here, we're honored to partner with the county, continue the long partnership that we've had with the county to make sure people have appropriate information, to make sure that people have legal representation and legal assistance when they encounter immigration officials, and that, again, we work together to make the lives of all residents of King County, regardless of where they were born or how much money they have, be respected and be valued. I'm honored to introduce my colleague, Michael Ramos, who's the Executive Director of the Church Council of Greater Seattle.
Morning. On behalf of the faith community, I want to thank Executive Constantine for his steadfast support for all of the county's residents, especially for committing to protect all of our residents as part of our wider community. All people have a fundamental human dignity that needs to be respected. I appreciate the investment in legal support and furthering the rights of all the people who are in our community, as well as investing in the resources to develop the capacity that exists in all our residents in this community. This county is a wonderful county, a vibrant economy, and it's built on the backs of immigrants and refugees who have helped this county to survive and to thrive over many years. There is a lot of fear in our community. Faith communities stand with public health, other community supports to ensure that we can alleviate suffering within our community, overcome fear, and to help create a healthy, vibrant community where we are humanizing situations of injustice, intolerance, hate, and violence. Faith communities will stand as hubs, places of refuge and support for our brothers and sisters who are in need and suffering, in combination with the other sectors, the legal supports, and county services that are provided within our community. And so we stand steadfast as people who believe in the God-given dignity of every human being to add the faith sector's voice to say that you are welcome here, you belong here, and we depend on you, our immigrant and refugee neighbors within our community, to help build up one united, vibrant community where we can all stand for dignity and justice together. Thank you.
And before we take questions, I also wanted to introduce to you the Executive Director of the American Muslim Empowerment Network, Anila Afsal.
She's been in a car accident.
Oh, no.
She's on her way, but she's late.
Okay.
So she will be here.
Sorry.
We'll open it up. Okay. So in that case, we will open up, and wasn't the traffic lovely this morning? We'll open up to questions, Essex.
Good morning. In this particular case you referenced, the federal agents are saying this is someone who is a self-admitted gang member. As you institute this program, are you concerned about using taxpayer money to protect criminals?
Criminals will be dealt with based on their criminal behavior through the court system. What I'm concerned about is that there are many, many in our community who are eligible to get on a path to legal residence and citizenship, or who in fact are legal residents who want to get on a path to citizenship, but don't know how, or don't have the resources, including the legal resources, to be able to move through that process. We also have people who are being intimidated, or can be intimidated, because of their immigration status, and we want to make sure that they're receiving protection. And so these organizations, immigrant rights organizations, for example, have been doing this work for many years but are under-resourced. We have the opportunity to quickly expand the capacity to engage with mothers and fathers, children in the community, and help them, if they are eligible, get on a path to legal status and to protect their human and civil rights.
I have a follow-up question that many of our viewers have been asking. And rightly or wrongly, many of our viewers perceive that the county is doing much more to help immigrants, many of them undocumented, than the county is doing to help our veterans. Is that the case?
It is not the case. Veterans are a high priority of the county, as evidenced by our Veterans and Human Services levy, and I'll be presenting a renewal of that levy for this fall with increased services for veterans. The fact is that some of the veterans in this very county have served this nation, although they are not themselves citizens. And as we are grateful to all veterans, so we are concerned for the well-being of all the people of this county, and we prioritize veterans, as that levy would indicate to you. But that doesn't mean that others don't need help as well. And we are going to do our best to help people who are currently under assault, currently under attack by this administration.
Do you fear retribution from the Trump administration?
You know, I don't know what they have in mind. What I do know is that we have to do the right thing.
But they said they're going to cut federal funds.
I do not have the ability to change our treatment of members of our community based on some outside threat or possibility of some outside threat. If there's a person in our community who's going to school with your kids, who's playing soccer with them, a person who's working side by side with us, and they are fearing for themselves and their families, we have an opportunity and I think an obligation to help them, to extend a hand. That does not mean that we are unmindful of all of these practical challenges in dealing with the new administration, but we know that we have a higher obligation and that folks are relying on us now to help.
Have you had any communication with the Trump administration?
I've not directly. I have not directly had communication with the Trump administration, but of course we have folks who work with the agencies on a daily basis, and we work with our congressional delegation directly as well. And they, I will tell you, are champions. Champions for all the people in this community. Very much appreciate.
Do you happen to know off the top of your head how much federal money the county gets? I know that's been the threat from the president.
I don't know. Yes.
What sort of legal services will be available for
your family? Well, I would like to ask some of the folks here who provide these kinds of services on a regular basis, what we'll be able to expand by investing in some money.
Well, so I don't want to overstep the county's decision. Obviously, I think there's going to be a process in allocating those resources, but I think some of the needs that we know exist in the community are certainly legal information and community education right now, and making sure people understand their basic rights. but also representation of people who are facing immigration cases before the immigration courts, as well as help. We're seeing a tremendous increase in need for people who are lawful permanent residents who are trying to pursue naturalization citizenship applications. I think a lot of it actually has stemmed from the travel ban that President Trump attempted to put in place, that has led a lot of community members to be even fearful of you know, what the Trump administration could do to people who are not yet U.S. citizens.
And as part of this, how much money will there?
I don't think there's been decisions made about any allocations to any particular organization. So.
Right now, there's no evidence that the Trump administration is telling authorities to go after Dreamers or DACA recipients. And some on the other side may say, why make this a political thing when even under the Obama administration, you had these routine raids, per se. Any response to that?
We first of all, we've had our differences with the Obama administration over these issues as well. Over the entire course of the Obama administration, we had an ongoing conversation with Homeland Security about the propriety of them demanding that we hold people in jail. The judges have said, free to go. And we have refused in cases to obey administrative orders. We tell them, if you want us to hold someone in jail, you need to have a judge issue a warrant for that person. So this is not a new issue. It is, however, the fact that the case that the Homeland Security has been talking, has been issuing statements about the fact that they are increasing these kinds of activities. And we are, people in our community are deeply concerned. And because of the abruptness of the travel ban, we see that these folks in D.C. are taking their rhetoric from the campaign and moving it into actions that, well, not well considered, and in this case, not even legal, are tremendously hurtful to people and inspire fear. We want people who need legal help, who need other kinds of material assistance, to be able to get it now, because the level of fear is dramatically increased. And I think that you see, as well, the federal government is, in fact, confirming that they're increasing enforcement.
You talk about fear, and that's my follow-up question. So the perception, obviously, and a lot of people feeling fear in the immigrant community, but is there actual numbers that show that they are ramping up in this area?
I'm going to let others respond to that because I don't have those numbers, but if anybody else wants to talk about the notion of increased enforcement activity by the federal government, I'd be happy to have them do that either here or in an individual interview.
Well, I will just... I don't think we have specific data. It's only been a month of the changes, and unfortunately, immigration is not very transparent when it comes to releasing information. And so, I think that would be a question that you could ask them about the numbers. But I do think that we've, at least anecdotally from what the comments that we're hearing from people, there is a significant increase in people who were not considered priorities under the Obama administration being picked up in the last few weeks, because the president indicated that through the executive order that he issued on January 25th, which, you know, significantly expanded the categories to such a point that I think most people consider that every undocumented individual, if not most undocumented individuals, could be considered a priority for enforcement, which is a significant difference from what President Obama had outlined in the past 2 years. Although I echo what Executive Constantine said, that there was still, you know, a significant level of enforcement even under the Obama administration. But I think that I think President Trump indicated very clearly during the campaign that he wanted to shift into a whole different level of enforcement.
Where does your group stand on if they're an undocumented immigrant and they commit a crime? Where does your group stand on that? Should they be deported or should they not be deported?
So we have a criminal justice system that addresses criminal matters, so that everybody in the country is subject to that. So this is not about the fact that we have protection for people from the criminal justice system. In fact, I think that it's important to note that, you know, in order to have a safer community, we need to have people who are comfortable reporting incidents to local law enforcement.
The way I'd like to illustrate it to people is, you know, think about somebody walking, who's undocumented, walking past your house right now, and somebody's breaking into your house right now. The undocumented person decides not to make the call because they're afraid that local law enforcement is working with immigration enforcement. Now, an undocumented person's going to be fine. They just keep walking down the street, but your house will get broken into, and the next person's will get broken into because nobody contacted law enforcement. So if we want our communities to be safer, we should be separating immigration enforcement from the criminal justice system. If somebody breaks the criminal law, they can be held accountable for that system, but we should not be conflating immigration with the criminal justice system.
First of all, thank you, Jorge. The last bit is a very important point that we have to deal with as a local government service provider every day. We need people, regardless of their immigration status, to be willing to report crimes. We need them to be willing to testify in court. We need them to be willing to bring their child who's sick to a public health clinic before that illness becomes more widespread. Having people be afraid to engage with their local government is dangerous to every single person in this county, this community. And that has been the part of the ongoing conversation we had with the Obama administration, and now clearly with this administration. We're not able to keep people safe, we're not able to keep people healthy if we have folks who are not willing to engage with their local government. We're now fortunate to have Executive Director of American Muslim Empowerment Network, Neela Asali, here to share a few words with us.
Thank you so very much, Executive Constantine. And I apologize to all of you. I was in a car accident this morning, so I do apologize for that. That's going to start the morning. But good morning to all of you. My name is Neela Asali, and I am the Executive Director of NAPS Amen. I'm a proud American Muslim, but right now I'm hurting as both an American and a Muslim. The policies and actions by the administration have created widespread fear and anxiety among many communities, including the American Muslim community. And even American Muslims have felt the impact of that. And this follows on years of anti-Muslim sentiment, hate speech, and conspiracy theories, and millions of dollars spent by certain groups to demonize Islam and Muslims. We see the fruits of this in the increase of hate crimes by 67% in the year 2015 against American Muslims. This is unprecedented levels in our country. And we see it in the policies, appointments, and rhetoric of the new administration. At such a time of crisis, King County's leadership and actions today provides hope. King County is talking the talk along with walking the walk by making clear that we are a welcoming community for all and investing money to make it so. We know that immigrants and refugees strengthen King County and contribute significantly to our economy and prosperity. As part of the workforce, as small business owners, CEOs of Fortune 500 companies, doctors, lawyers, IT, and more, immigrants and refugees contribute billions to our state. They pay taxes and add tens of thousands of jobs to Washington's economy. So taking action to protect immigrants and refugees is not only the right thing to do, but it also makes financial sense. I know the immigrant story firsthand, as my own family came here to America as immigrants. Like millions of others, my parents worked extremely hard and sacrificed so much to provide a better life for their children. They also opened 3 family businesses. Thanks to their hard work, I was the first in my family to attend college, but fortunately not the last. And I got to continue on to Harvard Law School to graduate from there. And my sister is now a doctor at Harvard U. That's the American dream. That's what makes America great. And as Americans, as patriots, it's our duty to preserve our cherished American values of religious freedom and our beautiful bipartisan tradition of welcoming children and families seeking refuge and opportunity in our great land, rather than tearing apart families and targeting people based on religion. So we applaud King County for funding these critical programs at this time, and we call on all fair-minded leaders and everyday Americans to also invest time and money to these worthwhile programs and speak out to address some of the underlying problems of some of the policies and actions we're seeing today, which include Islamophobia, xenophobia, and racism. And one specific action people can take is to use the media, write a letter to the editor, and speak about, publicly speak about the lives and contributions of the American Muslims you know, of the immigrants you know, of the refugees you know, and share these stories to humanize and personalize all of us to our fellow Americans, particularly when the majority of Americans do not personally know a Muslim. By uplifting the most marginalized and vulnerable in our communities, we actually uplift us all. So thank you very much.
So thank you all. We're, folks here will be available to answer questions directly to you. Again, I will be transmitting this legislation tomorrow. I want to thank Councilwoman McDermott for being here and for assuring us the County Council is going to carry this forward, and Mayor Baker for your courageous leadership of the cities and the Sound Cities Association, cities, dozens of cities across King County. Thank you so much.